Welcome to the very first premiere first, very first, first premiere first episode of Magic the PROthering.
From here on out, for future episodes, I'm going to buy Maria a thesaurus.
Oh, okay.
So she has new ways to say second episode and third episode.
It'll be handy.
Repeating the word over and over and over again.
We're the hosts, Meghan and Maria, of Magic the Amateuring. You may know that's a show for complete magic noobs.
Absolutely. Or players returning to the game.
Or players who like to have a laugh in the bath. But guess what? Those players can get the heck out of there, because this is Magic the PROthering.
That's right. Or they can stay the heck in here, uh-huh. Because they are also invited.
You're also welcome. Everyone's welcome. I'm sorry I said
that. Exactly. It's like on a Facebook invite, instead of de-inviting people and adding new people, we just kept the people we had already invited so it didn't get awkward, and then we added new people.
That's right. So welcome to Magic the PROthering, the once a month episode where we talk to a Magic pro, and we're kicking it off with my personal favorite pro.
Maria, tell us who is your personal favorite pro and the person who is on the line right at this very minute.
It's Eric Froehlich.
Hey, Eric, how's it going?
Oh, it's going great. Absolutely great.
That sounded sarcastic, I gotta tell you.
Well, I mean, it's weird. You guys said we had to record in a bathroom because all of your interviews have been recorded in bathrooms lately. And it's just kind of a weird feeling. We're all kind of jammed up in this one small bathroom.
There's just not enough space, man,
for the three of us.
God. Look, we gave you the sink area, the area around the sink.
Mm-hmm.
Which I appreciate.
It's like, yeah, like that's like the A+ area of the bathroom.
I agree.
How many times do I have to thank you for the sink area? But still.
At least we didn't put you in the toilet area.
Exactly.
Thank your lucky stars.
We won't tell you again.
We tried.
We're not going to tell you what pros we're going to make stand in the toilet area.
Yeah, it's going to be, you know, somebody's going to have to do it at some point.
I'm faxing you a list right now.
Thank you. Faxing? Does anybody fax anymore?
Maria, turn on your fax machine.
I've never faxed in my life.
Actually, I do have a fax machine that I'm sitting right next to.
To be fair, it's part of your printer.
Yeah, but I'm going to call it my fax machine.
You didn't ask for it to happen.
No, that's true.
Came with all the other stuff.
Well, Eric, thank you for joining us in this bathroom for the first inaugural episode of Magic the PROthering.
Inaugural, huh?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It is.
All right.
You also...
You met all my demands. They were plentiful.
Yeah, that's true. We should clue the listeners in. Eric gave us a list of demands that needed to be met in order for him to be our first guest on this show.
I mean, every guest gets a rider.
Yeah, and yeah, one of the demands was to basically wipe all of green M&Ms off the face of the earth.
Yeah.
That was tough. We did it, though.
So if you, as a listener, miss green M&Ms, I mean, we're sorry, but this is what you get in return.
Yep.
I mean, part of filling all of the demands, you can't even apologize for it.
Yeah, no, we're not apologizing.
No.
I'm saying
no.
Screw you if you miss green M&Ms.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like,
exactly.
It happened.
Deal with it.
They're gone.
And it was from all the green rooms because of the colors clashing.
Exactly.
It's ridiculous.
You know, what a lot of people don't know about you is that you're really into design.
That is huge. That's basically my entire life, yeah.
Do you watch a lot of HGTV?
I assume so.
But I don't know.
I don't know what that is, but I probably do.
Oh.
Uh-huh.
It's home and garden television.
Oh, yeah. It's pretty much my whole life. I revolve around the schedule. I mean, when my weekly TV guide comes out, I go right to wherever you get TV guides and circle all of my favorite shows. They're mostly about gardening.
Yeah. Perfect.
And homes.
Absolutely. Las Vegas, notoriously friendly to gardening and plants.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's a lot of, you know, like very reasonable temperatures and like good amounts of rain.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's perfect gardening.
When I'm not casting spells, I'm watering stuff.
Beautiful.
Very poetic.
Eric, I want to ask you a cue.
Oh.
That's a question. I don't mean I want to ask you about the character Q in Star Trek.
Although if you have any opinions.
But do you have an opinion on Q from Star Trek?
Well, I got excited when I thought that's what we were talking about, but now I'm just filled with disappointment.
Okay, fine. We'll talk about Q. What's your favorite Q episode on Star Trek?
I have not seen any episodes of Star Trek.
Okay, god dang it.
Punked.
You just got punked by Steve and Steve. Now I'm the third Steve.
Ooh, cool.
Steve and Steve and Steve.
Steve.
Absolutely. So.
Yeah.
Maria.
Yes, Meghan.
You had a cue.
Oh, yeah. My cue was, basically, I want to know the Eric Froehlich story told to me in one sentence. It can be a run-on. You can use commas. But you cannot use any other punctuation other than commas and a period. So no semicolons.
No contractions. No colons. You cannot have apostrophes.
No apostrophes. I wanted to know how you came to play Magic the Gathering. Go.
Well, in West Philadelphia, born and raised, on the playground is where I spent most of my days. Chilling out, I was born and raised in Philly, but I moved to Virginia. My class in fifth grade, I can date myself nicely. I went to a special school that had a lot of advanced things going on, and my fifth grade teacher actually won Teacher of the Year and basically set up an economy system where we formed government, we formed shops, we had stores, we had money, banking, had to basically learn all about various things in politics and interest and lots of cool things going on there. And one of the things that people did to make money in shops and, you know, the big fad at the time, besides, of course, Pogs, was Magic the Gathering. And so the entire fifth grade class, which composed of actually two classes and about 60 students, all the boys, all the girls, everyone played Magic. And so this was something that was common, and we'd play during our, you know, set free time for, you know, like economy time and, you know, recess and lunch and after school, there'd be a little bit of Magic. Some people were into it just for the collectability and, you know, the pretty pictures. But basically everyone played, and so it was kind of cool. And, you know, my dad took me to the local comic book shop and bought me a revised starter kit, which was the thing at the time, which is basically just two sealed decks, which also aren't things anymore. And basically came with like 120 cards and a bunch of rares and uncommons and commons. And I could not understand any of the rules, so he read the entire rule book and taught me and my brother how to play. My brother at the time was about 7. I was, I guess, 10. And the three of us played, and my class played. And by the time sixth grade rolled around, it was only me and one other kid in school who still played Magic. The fad was dead, but I enjoyed it. I played a lot of sports growing up. I was into baseball, basketball, and football, but, you know, Magic was just an interesting thing to do, and I played a little bit of chess and other brain games, but they, you know, not having the variance and, you know, the best player basically always winning does kind of get repetitive and old, especially if you're in a smaller environment, you're a kid, you're not traveling around the world, so you're playing against the same people all the time, and Magic was different and cool and kept changing, and there were a lot of things I really enjoyed. I was a very cocky, loud, annoying, obnoxious kid that I would not want to be around myself right now. But that is just how it was, and I wish that wasn't the case. There are things I certainly regret about that, but that is what it was. And so, I just kept playing Magic when all my friends stopped. And they had the first, I guess it was the second Grand Prix ever, but it was in Washington, D.C. in 1997. And I was 13 and convinced my dad to take me, and I managed to make top 8 there. I couldn't end up going to the Pro Tour because my family moved houses only a couple miles away from where we were, but it got delayed until the weekend of the Pro Tour, so I ended up not being able to go because, it was different, though. I mean, it's 20 years ago, and the Pro Tour wasn't like, it was a cool thing, it was something I really cared about, but it wasn't this thing that, you know, everyone's talking about, and there's millions of Magic players, and everyone knows what it is. Like, it was something I wanted to do, and it was a cool big tournament that I was excited to be a part of, but it didn't have the same, I don't know, like, allure that it has right now, where if you had to, like, miss your first Pro Tour, and you've been playing the game for so long, and you know what the Pro Tour is, you'd be, you know, pretty upset about that. And for me, I was upset, but I was a kid and I was determined to get back there. And eventually I did. And yeah, I just kept playing from there. I cashed my first Pro Tour. I was 15 in 1999. And God. Yeah, I kept going.
No idea that you were so young when you started playing and when you were playing at the Pro Tour nonetheless. That's awesome.
The funny thing is, like, this is the age that we hear a lot about people like Shahar right now being, you know, just turning 22 and how young he is. But my age was closer to what the age of what everyone played. The players that you know today, you know, a lot of the Hall of Famers are people I grew up playing with. I mean, my friend group was William Huey Jensen and Ben Stark and John Finkel and Bob Marr. And, you know, all these guys were, much younger. Like they are the age they are now, but this was again like 17, 18 years ago for some of them, and it's just, it is what it is. Like I was the youngest, but not by much. I mean, most of these guys are a year or two older than me, but I was 15 and they were 16 and 17, so that was kind of the norm back then. I had already quit playing Magic by the time, I really didn't take it seriously anymore by the time I was almost 18. I was basically done. I went to a few pro tours until I was like 19 and 20, but yeah, I really wasn't as involved with Magic. I went to poker, playing a lot of poker when I turned 21. That's when I just stopped going to Pro Tours entirely, and I ended up getting a special invite in 2010 for everything I did in poker, and that was my first Pro Tour back in San Diego in early 2010. The one where Luis Scott Vargas went 16-0. That was my first time really meeting him, although he told me that we played in his first Pro Tour years earlier. And I didn't know. He said I destroyed him very quickly, didn't say a word to him. I saw the name, I'm sure, on the pairing board, and I'm just like, okay, this has got to be an easy opponent, like Luis Scott Vargas, like random Chilean guy. I'll just go beat this guy and go back and hang out with my friends. And that's exactly what happened. So, yeah, worked out.
Wow.
That's actually hilarious, because I was listening to an interview with Luis the other day where he mentions that he played you. Like back when he, again, like way back in the past, and you had no idea who he was, and you just crushed him.
I think it's really cool that it's extremely memorable to one of us.
Sick burn.
Nice. No, that's awesome. I love that story had such great teaching and dadding in it. Great, yeah. Teacher and great dad, man.
And you were a poker player / are a poker player. You still play a lot of poker?
No, not really. I have to focus on Magic and appearing on podcasts.
Thank you. Thank you for taking time out of your busy Magic schedule.
Take note, everybody. We really pay the big bucks for this.
Yeah, we did. So, like, for you, being a professional, would you call yourself a professional Magic player? Is that, like, your job?
More or less. I think that when you say that, it can mean a lot of different things. And for a lot of people, it's tough because you're not going to be able to just go to tournaments week in and week out and that's my living, you know, we did it. That you have to be platinum to basically be at that break even for a typical cost of sustaining just one person on a pretty modest budget. That's kind of, you know, the starting point. You have to already be a platinum level player, and that's pretty hard to attain. So for the average player, it's not really realistic. You have to supplement it in a number of ways, and there are a lot of ways to do it between, you know, being an entertaining personality like yourselves. You can do a lot of things with podcasting. You can do a lot of things with Twitch and writing articles, but you really do have to have those supplemental ways or you just can't really get by.
Yeah, that's true. And we hear that from a lot of players who are trying to make it and how very difficult it is to maintain kind of a living. Yes. Doing this.
That being said, there are a lot of opportunities if you are, you know, good at what you do to make reasonable money writing articles. And there is a big market in Magic. Of course, it's a big game and the stores and websites are looking for talented people and they do pay fair wages. So you can definitely get by, but you do have to put in that work and effort and do something else. You can't just, I play Magic and I'm going to support a family.
So one of the things that you've kind of branched out and started doing recently is coverage. How are you liking that?
Coverage is awesome. Talking about Magic is fun. I'm sure you guys probably understand.
What are you talking about?
It's torture.
Every time I do it, torture. I feel like the screws are tightening, you know?
Well, they are, but at the same time. No, it's great. The people that I've gotten to work with are, of course, fantastic. Many of them are close friends of mine, between Marshall and Luis, and I've done coverage with Ben Stark. And being able to do it on the Pro Tour level was amazing. I've only got to do that one time, but it was really a lot of fun and something I've wanted to do forever. And it's something I've considered if, you know, a reasonable enough offer presented itself, which isn't really realistic to not play Magic, that doing coverage is something that I could see myself really enjoying doing for a very long time. Not playing Magic is a tough compromise to make to be able to actually cover Magic. So it is tough in that regard, in that when I'm flying out to a tournament, not being able to play is a little bit painful. I really enjoy it. The competition is fantastic, and of course it's the best game ever made. But that being said, being there and being able to talk about Magic and analyze Magic and still get to hang out with so many fantastic people, it's a lot of fun. I enjoyed it a lot.
What does a day look like for you? An average day where you're just having a day?
I shouldn't talk about this.
Fair enough.
Top secret. Top secret. No, I mean,
wake up, hang out with Athena, read a few magic articles while having either Chion or Jerry or Kenji or someone on in the background on Twitch. I have basically a Twitch stream open most of my waking hours, and then she makes me food and I eat it, and that's great.
Sick.
And then I watch sports for about 6 hours, and then sometimes we watch TV shows or movies, or I watch her stream or something like that, and then I'm tired because I've done a lot. I celebrate that with sleeping.
Which stream are you watching right now?
Yeah, well, you're doing this interview.
I'm watching 3 basketball games and Monday Night Football.
Oh, my God. Do you have one of those TVs from Back to the Future 2 where it shows 5 channels all at once?
I do, but I also just have a lot of TVs.
Okay, I suppose both things
multiple
work.
Multiple Back to the Future TVs.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. We are definitely in the future and have gone back there.
Nice. How are those self-lacing shoes?
Oh, they're awesome. Oh, yeah.
Absolutely.
I have a problem with mine. Mine get too tight. They lace up and then they constrict my feet.
They're trying to tell your feet to lose weight.
How dare you?
I know. Wow. Nike is super judgmental about women's feet.
Can't say that on podcasts.
Meghan, my feet are very happy with their current body image.
Look, I'm not saying it. I'm saying that we need to point out that Nike has a women's foot agenda about the way that they think women's feet should look.
Oh, there's no arguing that.
Oh, Nike, God. I'm calling you out. It's not okay. My feet are super flat. And you know what? They're happy like that. That was a foot poem.
That was a great poem. It even rhymed.
Thank you. So what would you say if you had to pick, like, your favorite best thing about magic, what would it be? You can only name one.
If you name two, I'm coming to your house. Well, you're not going to know when. And I'm going to sneak in, and I'm going to tickle you with a feather duster.
That's creepy.
Okay, so we've now locked me in at saying two.
Really creepy threat.
I mean, number one is not even close to anything else, but it's not really fair based on your question because it's the people. I mean, that's what got me. That's what hooked me into magic. That's what kept me coming. That's what stopped me from coming, honestly, is that a lot of my friends and the people I was closest with stopped going. They found poker. They found other things. We kind of grew up. Like I said, everyone was in that 16 to 18 range, and once you kind of get to that 18 to 21 range, it kind of felt like this was the kids' game, and we were moving on to the adult game. And honestly, what poker was in that time period was incredible. Like, if you were of essentially average intelligence and put in a little bit of time and effort to get okay, you were going to win. It was like the wild, wild west of money being thrown at you. Like, it was actually just incredibly challenging to lose. Like, having a losing month was just almost unheard of for a lot of people, depending on how much you're willing to gamble. If you weren't playing with the highest stakes against the best players in the world, you were going to be able to grind out a good salary, and everyone I knew was doing it.
Wow.
And so it became silly not to in a lot of ways. And that's changed dramatically, changing the laws and making online poker no longer legal, making it harder to online bank and put money in there has restricted things dramatically. But that really is how it felt for a long period of time, is that poker had hit this big boom. Everyone was putting a lot of money in, and it was just kind of ripe for the pickings for the intelligent people. And, you know, it sucked in a lot of ways because you're not really contributing to society, and you're taking advantage of people who are not necessarily on the same level as you and your friends. But, you know, it was a great living for a long period of time. And so that's what a lot of people did. And a lot of them started coming back to Magic, and I missed Magic. Like, once I got that invite, I ended up skipping one of the biggest poker tournaments at the time to go play this Pro Tour. And this was kind of the middle of my poker career. This was, you know, about 6 years ago. And that was an easy decision to make, but also a painful one, because I know I'm giving up a lot of equity and just monetary value. But at that point, being able to play Magic was such a big appeal, and being able to see some of the people that, you know, I was friends with, I didn't get to spend time with anymore, because that was what I really look forward to in doing the travel. And it still is to this day. I really enjoy testing for tournaments beforehand and being able to hang out with a lot of my closest friends, and doing that while playing a great game is a huge bonus. And I do feel like Magic it's getting tougher and tougher to win, because they're making changes to gradually increase variance nonstop, which is great for Magic as a game. It allows more people to have more opportunities to win, and it's a lot worse for players who are kind of at the top. But that
being
said,
can you give an example of that?
Planeswalkers.
Yeah.
Siege Rhino. You know what happens when someone casts Siege Rhino? They start attacking with it. They can't really mess it up. Like, that's the thing. Like, that's not how Magic used to be. It used to be that you could be mana screwed and you'll have just time to come out of it, because they can't get that far ahead where your, you know, tight decisions later on in the game are going to make a big difference. Now they'll just cast their Siege Rhino and attack with it. Like, you can't do anything about that. And Planeswalkers are so powerful that you have to change the way that you build your decks, and you need to have answers, because if they've just resolved their Planeswalker, even if they don't play it particularly well, if you're, you know, kind of struggling and mana screwed, or, you know, just not developing, you're not curving out, you're just going to lose. There's really nothing you can do. And so the variance is much higher, and the skill matters a lot less. That being said, there's still tons of skill in the game. Don't get me wrong. The best players are still winning a good percentage. It's just nowhere near what it was before. Like,
interesting.
That's why we saw, you know, John Finkel's 14 top eights. None of the great players nowadays have close to that. Like, you know, there's a couple people who, like, Paulo has now put up his 10th top eight, which is pretty absurd, but he also has no top 16. So a lot of that is just, you know, the variance of when things were close, he was able to get top eight and not get top 16s. And most people will have, like, that normal bell curve distribution where they'll have four or five top eights and four or five top 16s, and it'll look more normal. I think, you know, mine is, you know, four top eights and six or seven top 16s, which is, you know, a little bit more normal distribution with not running quite as well at the end, or, you know, something along those lines. The difference between top eight and top 16 is so small. But
absolutely.
Yeah, those are the power creep that you keep hearing about, and seeing how ridiculous some of these cards are that, you know, you can't really interact with them. If it gets cast, you're just kind of going to lose. Or if you don't play your third land, you're just kind of going to lose because Siege Rhino's down. And then
power creep was over, my nickname in college, by the way.
And to this day.
To this day.
You did make the feather threat. So that's all
I
remember.
Did. That's
Maria
true.
Got the power creep.
I do.
So tell us, you know, the flip
really
side of that
the
is
creep and power creep.
Thank you.
What's the worst thing about Magic right now, and why is it Siege Rhino?
Well, I'll tell you, Steve. It's Siege Rhino.
Oh yeah. Oh wow, that's surprising. You know, I always thought that Siege Rhino was so great.
Oh, it's fantastic. It's done everything for me and more.
I am personally, this is Steve talking now, I've said this on the show before, I think, I would rather that Planeswalkers didn't exist.
Yes. I think that it would be a more interactive game in a lot of ways. And the things that you can do in deck building are dramatically different. The fact that you can't really, like, you used to be able to play these creatureless decks and do a lot of cool things that you just really weren't able to do without now playing cards that are kind of ridiculous in a lot of ways, where you just have to have answers to Planeswalkers, and the best of those are of course things that can attack them, which a lot of people are just then playing Planeswalkers to do that. So
right, sometimes it's, you know, you'll see a board state and then, like, there's a Planeswalker down, the other person has a Planeswalker, there's a bunch of tokens out there, and you're just like, ugh, who cares? I mean, it's just like a mess. I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, the fact that you're able to play, like, these Wrath of God type sweepers, and that was going to actually solve your problems, as opposed to, well, now I have to deal with the still biggest problem of dealing with this Gideon that's just going to kill me anyway. It's like, all right, well, that's just a tough card to beat. And, you know, they're very cool, and I think they've done great things for Magic. I think sales have probably elevated dramatically, and they continue to elevate dramatically because of things like variance. That is great for getting players involved. You want everyone to have a chance. You want to know that when you sit down and play against Louis Scott Vargas that you're going to have a chance to win. And people have been proving that every Pro Tour.
Sick
sick burns.
No, I mean, same for me. I did not make day two in the last Pro Tour.
Where do you hope, like, that the game is going? What do you hope to see?
To infinity and beyond.
Well, yeah. I mean, what does that mean to you? A DeLorean. No, wait. That's Toy Story. Whoops. Mixed in my movies.
Yeah, I would like it to get to a place where it can compete with esports and some of the other things going on where you can actually make a real living by just playing Magic. Like, there is so much money being made off of Magic, and that number, I think, can increase dramatically by paying out more. That's my opinion, and I've talked to a lot of smart people who agree that the biggest way to expand, to go from, let's say, 10 million players to 100 million players, is to have the prize pools be just ridiculous, to have, you know, really open up people's eyes and have parents encourage their kids to be good at this game, because it's not just throwing away your money. It's, you know, you can make a real living, and being able to see people winning six figures at Pro Tours and, you know, decent five figures at Grand Prix, that's, I think, the way that you make the game explode. And it's already expanded dramatically, but I think that would be a great place. And you see people tweeting that the best players in the world are basically struggling to make as much as, you know, kind of the lower rung school teacher. And we all know that school teachers are heinously underpaid. Yes. And so that when you have a profession where the very best in the world can't make as much as the most criminally underpaid profession, it's just like, all right, well, this is not something you can really encourage your children to do, or that, you know, is necessarily a great idea. The game is fantastic and it's fun, but it's hard to invest, you know, your life into that.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think you were mentioning before about how a lot of people end up supplementing with writing or with working for game stores. But yeah, it's hard for someone to be like, you know, just playing.
Yes, very challenging.
Yeah, and we're on board with you. I think that it would be better for the game if it were an environment where people could realistically think that they could make enough, and then they could spend more time doing it outside of actually going to tournaments and whatnot. It would be more exciting and more rewarding for them to do that. I think it would be a better environment overall. But, you know, who am I to say? I've never made a Pro Tour or day two at a GP.
I'm also not a financial advisor.
Yeah,
I mean, the entire landscape of the gaming industry and Magic as a whole would be so different with those kind of numbers, and yeah. It would be really interesting to see, and it would be really fantastic for, of course, a lot of people, and I think the game as well.
Absolutely. I think that's actually, I haven't heard that talked about a whole lot, but, like, yeah, when, like, listening to you talk about it just now, it's like, yeah, I would love to see the game go that direction also. And really see, like, the recognition and the prestige of Magic in the gaming world in general go up.
And pay out in a way that reflects that prestige.
Yes, exactly.
Well, yeah. A couple Grand Prix ago, myself, Louis Scott Vargas, and Ben Stark in the team Grand Prix got second place. And I'm taking an Uber on the ride back. And, you know, she's asking us how we did. And I just happened to be in the car with the team that got third place. And, you know, we're like, oh, yeah, we got, you know, second and third out of, you know, thousands of people were there. Like, oh, wow. Like, that must be so incredible. Like, how much did you make? And I'm like, I wouldn't want to talk about it anyway, but really don't want to talk about it. She's like, no, come on. How much did you make? I'm like, well, it was about enough to basically cover the flight and hotel. Like, that was it. That was what we made. Like, yep. All right. Well, yeah, it's just when you top eight a Grand Prix and you're like, yeah, you know, I broke even. Like,
yeah.
Good work, everyone.
Absolutely. I remember, I don't remember exactly who I was talking to, but it was around when the Pro Tour was happening. I was talking about, like, oh, you know, like, I'm watching the Pro Tour. And they're like, oh, man, that must pay out, like, what's the top prize for that? Uh-huh. And I was just like, oh.
40 grand.
Not as much as you think it's going to be. I could tell you the number and you would be disappointed, so let's just pretend like it's bigger.
Maybe this is what we should do. We're going to, both of us, you and me, Meghan,
yeah,
we're going to marry, like, a crazy sugar daddy from, like, some foreign country, okay? He's going to be a billionaire.
Okay.
And then we're going to kill him in his sleep, and then we'll take that money and put it into Magic for the winnings.
Yeah.
What do you say?
You know, by recording this, you're kind of killing your odds of actually being able to do this.
I was going
to
say, Maria, I've found a flaw.
I mean, it's a
plan.
Great idea, but
all right.
That's how we just talked about it.
All right, Eric, we have a question for you from a listener. It reads, so I just qualified for PT Atlanta via an RPTQ berth last weekend, which is awesome, but I don't know what to do from here. I'm not a part of one of the bigger teams, and therefore I will not have limited experts on hand to help me grasp the draft format. I'm pretty set on my modern game thanks to my local team, and I will have a couple of weeks after the set is spoiled to make some guesswork on the new format. So my question is, what do you suggest I do to prepare, get any insight? My understanding is that new sets don't hit MTGO soon enough for adequate preparation?
That's a good question. It depends on what you view, I guess, as adequate preparation. You can definitely get in a lot of drafts. I think for the last several Pro Tours, people on my team have been able to get in 20 or more drafts on Magic Online. The set certainly comes out early enough that if you do have a group of people that you play with, even if they're not the best players in the world, they really don't have to be to just get a grasp on what's working, what's not. It's not like you need to invent the wheel and really solve the entire format. You're just looking for good ideas and some decent synergies and some things that might not be obvious that you might have missed. You'll want to see how some of the rares play out, because it tends to be pretty obvious what like the best commons are going to be. They're going to be those really powerful creatures or those powerful removal spells. It's not, you know, generally too confusing. And if you get things off by a little bit, you really don't get punished that much. This is something I've tried to teach to my team a number of times when people are like, well, do you take this card over this card or not? When I say it's close, I'm like, well, I don't know. I haven't played enough to have a firm answer. But honestly, if one card is like an 8 out of 10, the other one's a 7.9, the amount that you're losing by making the wrong pick just isn't that big. And so in those situations, you're often able to take the card that fits your style a little bit more, but you need to figure out what that is, what you enjoy drafting, what you're winning with. And yeah, you just figure things out from there. You just try to get the best idea you can, the best handle. Do as many drafts on Magic Online as you can, which you really can get a lot in, because I mean, someone like me, I can play several at once, but even if you're only playing one at a time, you really do have about a full week to do that. And yeah, just talk to your friends, see what they're liking, and maybe get together with a couple friends in your house and have everyone drafting at once so you get more experiences going on and get some good dialogue in there as well. And you should be able to get a pretty good grasp on it.
And, you know, that's not to say that some people prepare for Pro Tours completely by themselves. I mean, not absolutely. Everybody's on a team, so don't despair, young Sam. And good luck high five out there.
Boom, snap.
Hey, on a lighter note, I want to know, Meghan and I are really, we love the idea of designing a set for Wizards, and our ideas are flawless.
Pancakes.
Like pancakes. Very good. You've done your homework.
Waffles.
Oh, yeah. Waffle theme set. I personally want a Huey Lewis in the News theme set. What
who doesn't? Yeah.
Would you design if you could design a set for Wizards?
What?
It's well, okay. You can take a moment.
Obviously, it would have to, you know, be about homes and gardens.
No, you're right. We completely forgot.
There'd be Feather Duster the Seeker, of course, would be the Planeswalker of choice. And
yeah.
That sounds like absolutely. A Beauty and the Beast theme set.
Instead
this,
of having
this feels
like
an amateuring question. Come on.
Instead of a stasis snare, it would be bathroom. It would be bathroom sink area.
Yeah, of course. That is where people get trapped.
Absolutely.
And exiled.
Yes, you are going to be living in my bathroom in the sink area forever.
Yes. You didn't realize.
Did you know that was my plan?
Yep. You didn't realize what prime real estate it was, because it's only going to get more crowded in there as we add more pros to the Prothering.
Oh,
not
yeah.
really in the sink area. They're going to be in the toilet.
No, exactly. But like you got first pick of bathroom space. The rest of them are just going to have to, you know.
It is an honor. It's an honor just to be nominated, honestly.
So if you, what is your favorite card in all of Magic history?
Shivan Dragon.
Can you do an impression of Shivan Dragon?
No, but Maria can.
Okay, come on now. But I can. It is perfect.
You can?
Yeah, do you want to?
We've done this before and I like forgot.
Me and Eric practiced for a while and he sent me like a script and I've been working on it.
Oh, okay, yeah.
It was a solid 2-week boot camp.
Mm-hmm. I did a lot of squats, a lot of deep bends.
Oh, yeah, dragons have notoriously great legs.
Thighs.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. All right. Are you
mostly what they're known for?
Yeah.
Are you ready?
Yes.
I'm Shivan Dragon. Look at me. I'm a red card. I'm a just classic dragon. I breathe fire. I poop eggs. I'm so mad.
Follow-up question.
Yep.
Can I hear your Ian McKellen impression?
Sure, one second.
Yeah.
I'm Ian McKellen.
Oh, okay. All right.
I wanted to hear about him pooping eggs.
I poop eggs. I was in Harry Potter.
What?
Was it?
You're way off.
I was in Lord of the Rings.
There you go.
I was also in this lovely little British show called Vicious.
Oh.
Yeah, great show, everybody. Check it out.
All right.
It's very silly and rather dumb, but if you're in a good mood, you might as well just eat a grilled cheese and watch it.
Eat a what of cheese?
Grilled cheese.
Oh, okay.
Except in Britain, they call them cheese toasties. Isn't that adorable?
That does sound better.
That's adorable.
Mm-hmm.
I would eat 10 cheese toasties before I'd eat one grilled cheese.
If
I had known about that, my demands would have included one more demand.
You can retroactively add a cheese toastie to your demands.
Yeah, but I feel like my demands don't have as much sway once I've already completed my end of the bargain.
That's true.
I feel like I just don't have the same pull demanding something in exchange for something I've already done.
But look, you're forgetting one classic fact is that Meghan and I live in Minnesota, and we are notorious pushovers.
It's true.
Oh,
Minnesotans,
yeah.
So.
Yeah, don't you know?
Don't you know?
Yeah, the thing is you just have to, like, suggest that we should give you a grilled cheese without
I don't know what that is anymore.
A cheese toastie.
Cheese toastie.
Without asking for one.
Yeah. Be like, oh, wouldn't it be so great if I had a cheese toastie right now? And we'd be like, oh, for sure. Hold on. Let me go make you one on the stove. It's cold out there. That's my natural accent, by the way. I hide it. This is me hiding it. What's the coldest it gets in? It gets pretty cold in Vegas, doesn't it, at night?
It's a desert.
Yeah, got down to 65.
Oh, my God. Don't even talk to me anymore.
But what's the
highest
temperature?
Too late, I just tweeted at you.
Dang it.
Just, it's 65 degrees at night.
If you don't tweet that at us, I'm going to be so mad. You better be typing it right now. Oh, God. Well, if you're not going to do an impression of a card.
You just did.
I did. You did not.
I can't do that impression. You've been working on that for years.
Thank you. But if you're not going to do it, what?
Eric, do you have an impression that you've been working on?
No.
Okay.
He made me do it.
I trained her to do it.
I understand, and it was really a stellar performance.
The master of deflection.
That's what I want to do, is try to show her up on her own show. Because that's gracious.
This is
just another punk. I know it.
This show is all about you, Eric. This is your show.
See? Yeah.
He's getting too embarrassed.
what could change my mind is a cheese toastie.
Oh. Okay, I'll go down right now. Make you one of those.
Well, we're going to put in a bubble mailer.
Oh, gross.
We had a friend who did that.
What?
Jill once mailed Nate a waffle.
Jeez, that is... What?
What, did he eat it?
I don't know. Anyways, that was just a weird aside, but we have a friend. She mailed someone a waffle. The end.
Okay. So if you're not going to do an impression of card, make me do an impression card. This is my follow-up question.
I didn't make you do anything.
Okay.
You decided it was a good idea.
He trained you.
Fine. I decided it was a great plan. We trained for 2 weeks. All right. If that's the case, follow-up question. Follow-up question. If a card was designed in your honor, what would that card be?
Jace the Mind Sculptor. They already did it.
That's fair enough.
It would be Eric the Mind Sculptor?
What? You're being ridiculous. Eric is not a character in Magic lore.
But look, it can be anything.
It was designed after me.
It's just like how Snapcaster Mage was someone.
Yes, exactly. I think I've done... Let me think about it. I did design a card for an Invitational a long time ago, but I can't remember anything.
Really?
Yeah, I ended up not making it to the Invitational, and I was very upset.
Oh, but you designed
that memory.
We're doing nothing but bringing up your most painful memories on this podcast, Eric.
It's pretty high on the list. Also, the not having cheese toasties. So, yeah.
Oh, yeah, you're right. I got to get it right on. Oh, yeah. Sorry. I'm really dragging my feet here.
Well, it's those shoes just got laced up too tight.
You're right.
Nike and their goddamn foot agenda. So tired of it. So I respect that. I've thought before if I could design any card, but it had to be a creature, I would just tack a creature onto a Sphinx's Revelation.
Yeah, that's exactly how everyone felt. There's a lot of people talking about, you know, their cards that they would make for the Invitational, but everyone kind of wants to make a spell. Spells were just so much cooler. And, of course, this was more than a decade ago when there weren't just siege rhinos and you couldn't just make things that were stupid and everyone would hate forever. So, you know, the spells were really the cool cards at the time, and the creatures were kind of just, these are just the things that go die to our spells.
Oh, sounds like heaven.
If I was, I would definitely make a creature card for me.
Really?
Yes.
What would it be like?
It would be called Sludge Clump. And it would be...
Those are the worst two words anyone has ever said in a row.
Sludge Clump.
No.
And it would be a star-star, because I think that's the prettiest power and toughness. And if I ever got a magic tattoo, that's what my tattoo would be. And
a star and a star?
A star with a slash and then a star.
So you just have some keyboard functions.
Not an asterisk.
Okay, you say so. And I like how you're just gonna walk into this tattoo parlor and be like, "I want this." You want asterisk / asterisk. You're like, "No,
no, no, no."
Pick up the sword. I want */*.
Yeah.
Excuse me, tattoo parlor, sir.
My card would be
nothing if it comes out */*.
It's true, but getting back to Sludge Clump. Sludge Clump, */*.
I was hoping we would never go back to Sludge Clump.
We're going to go back to Zendikar, we're going back to Sludge Clump. Any difference?
Sludge's power is equal to your opponent's clumpiness.
Which sludge is this?
Sludge Clump.
Oh, of course.
Nice. And Sludge's toughness is equal to your opponent's sludgeness.
Wait, so it's clump over sludge?
Yeah.
Why is it not Sludge over Clump?
I don't know.
Okay.
Just is. It just is.
She doesn't make the cards.
Yeah, it's just...
Comes up with the brilliant ideas. That's for R&D.
Thank you. That was brilliant.
Fair enough.
Just pass it off. You're like, I've done it.
Eric, you've played Magic in a lot of different places. You've probably played it in a bathroom. I don't know.
I am right now.
Okay, great. What's your favorite place... and also the worst place that you've ever played Magic?
This is literal place like bathroom or like city?
City.
City.
Or you can give us an actual location.
Or actual place.
Either one.
Bathroom is bad. I mean, when cards fall in the wrong area, they really do get ruined.
Have you ever played Magic in a hot tub? Have you ever had a hot tub draft?
I have played Magic in a hot tub many times, but not with paper Magic.
Oh, do you just, wait, you just like balance the computer on the outside of the hot tub and play?
I have a hot tub at my house and you've seen it.
Yes.
And I don't need to balance. It's just cement. I
mean, okay. I used
like
the wrong word.
It's a pretty solid surface.
I used the wrong word. Oh, wow. Okay. That's always been one of my dreams, is to have a hot tub, but a paper draft in a hot tub. So you have 8 people in the hot tub and you sit around the hot tub and you draft. What do you think?
I think it would be awesome. I think you could actually double sleeve the cards in such a way that they wouldn't get too badly ruined and you can just actually pass it in the water.
That would be so awesome.
That would be amazing.
Oh my gosh, great idea. Okay, but answer the question. Stop evading it. It was my fault.
I answered it exactly and specifically. Oh. I said never paper, but many times not.
Okay, so hot tub.
Other question, the original
question. Yeah.
Okay, that is a good question. I need to think about it.
Okay.
It really has nothing to do with the magic, though, right? It just has to do with which cities are my favorite.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I really, really like various places in California. San Diego is where I was going to move before what is known in the poker world as Black Friday, where online poker went away, and so did my income. So then I did not buy a very overpriced house in San Diego.
Fair enough.
What's that?
Oh, I was just saying, yeah, fair enough.
That's so interesting, though. I did not know that.
I actually knew an online poker player at that time, like, when that happened, and his life just got turned upside down.
That's so crazy.
Especially because he was living in Minnesota at the time, and Minnesota, there's not a lot of paper poker.
Yeah, well, the other thing that happened is when all of this happened is a lot of people just had the majority of their net worth in their account. It's like having Magic Online. Let's say you were just a Magic Online dealer, had a bunch of bots, and a lot of your money is tied up in tickets and cards, and Magic Online ceases to exist. It's not like you just get to cash out. It's just sitting there waiting for it. So that's what happened with online poker. I still haven't gotten my money back, and this is, you know, almost 5 years ago, and it's just gone at this point. You know, it's a reasonable amount of money, and for most people got their money back, but
I did not know that. That's crazy.
Yeah, everything just got frozen. The sites basically ceased to exist. So it was a pretty tough time for a lot of people.
So and in other countries, is it also outlawed? So it's not like you could like scoot on off to Sweden.
That varies. So. The way it worked was that people could go to other countries, and for there were two major sites at the time, and one of them basically got shut down, ended up eventually getting bought out by the other one, but the other one was run by smarter people at the time and could actually have the money to pay people, while the first one kind of Ponzi schemed it away. So a lot of people did end up leaving the country and setting up residency, and you had to be able to prove that you were actually living in a foreign country, and a lot of people did get their accounts unlocked and were able to play, and it depends on the country. There various countries have different rules. I believe you can't just play the international program, let's say from France. I believe it's illegal there, and other countries as well, but that is the option a lot of people took. And so I was living in Vegas at the time, and most of my friends, we all lived in the same high-rise condo that was right on the strip. It was really nice, and everyone was a professional poker player, and basically everyone moved out. A lot of them moved out of the country, and a lot of them tried to figure out other things to do. And so, it was a really tough time.
Aww.
But as far as places I've been, I really, really enjoyed my time every time I've gone to Japan. I think Japan's a fantastic country. And I felt the same way at Worlds in 2002, was in Australia. It's the only time I've been there, and I should be back next year for the Pro Tour. But those places were amazing. I think Japan is fantastic. Japanese food is easily one of my favorites, if not my favorite. The Japanese people in general are just extremely accommodating, and people actually really care about their jobs and their profession, and take them very seriously, from taxi drivers all the way on up. But the people get out of their taxi cabs to like help us move our luggage, because that's just, I don't know that much about Japanese culture, but that was my experience of people just bending over backwards to basically be accommodating, which was pretty amazing. The few times I've been there, again, my experience is not huge. I've only been there a few times, and for about a week each time, but I've really, really enjoyed it, and a lot of cool things. Japanese toilets are, of course, the best.
They sing little songs to you?
Oh, of course. I wish you had a Japanese toilet so I didn't have to sit in the sink, but don't. And a lot of cool technological things, and just a lot of great things going on there. And Australia, my time there, I felt like it was more or less a cleaner New York. It was very much mixing bowl, melting pot. Just a lot of the cool things about New York, but, you know, just a little bit cleaner, and not quite as many people, and not as much, you know, I guess you would say just garbage and inconsiderate, you know, things going on. And so, I really love that. Of course, both those places are further away than I would ever choose to travel, because I hate being on planes, and traveling is very tough on me, and I don't really enjoy it in general, but I did really enjoy my time there. And least favorite is a lot of the various places in Europe. I'm not a big Europe fan in general, although I do like a ton of European people. The travel and the basic comfort levels, they don't put as much in a lot of the places into comfort, and having beds that are not made of cardboard, or having air conditioning, or having, you know, just things that I'm used to, like technology and working elevators. Like, this is not common everywhere in Europe. And of course, there are plenty of places that are exceptions to that, but there are a number of places that that's just not something they care very much about. And so my time in Italy, I've had some great times in Italy, France, not so much, Spain, yes and no, kind of, it I've been there many times, and some trips have been great, and some have been not so great. I went to Dublin for the first time last year, and that was very cool. And I've been to Amsterdam a whole bunch of times with some fantastic experiences and some the World Championships. I famously was talking about how bad so many different things were a couple of years ago, but it was the hottest summer they ever had. There was no air conditioning. There was no internet to try to prepare. And so, like, I'm one of these people who needs the conditions to be pretty specific for me to be comfortable, and even like more specific to just survive, I guess. when it gets incredibly hot and I'm just sweating profusely, like little people like Shahar, just you can just wipe off their arms into like puddles of sweat, literally no exaggeration. And he's
sick.
He's just a small person. This is not like a normal thing to have happen while you're playing the World Championships of Magic. And so at that point, I just couldn't focus. I couldn't see straight. I just felt miserable. And so that kind of experience is a real downer for someone like me. But for the most part, a lot of good places. Magic tries to choose some of the cooler places. A lot of the places are not really memorable. I mean, I lived for years in Detroit. It's not, the most memorable. There are some cool things there. I mean, the last Pro Tour's in Milwaukee. It's not the most exciting place in the world. It's got some cool things. I enjoyed my time there for the most part, but it's not really memorable outside of, having the Hall of Fame ceremony, getting engaged, the actual city and stuff. It's not the most exciting.
Speaking of the Hall of Fame, Meghan has a question for you.
Yes, next question. If you could take the letters HOF and turn them into any other three letters that still represented you, what would you turn them into? I mean, what three words would they be instead of Hall of Fame?
This is the greatest question we've ever asked.
Yeah.
I was just going to run back Hall of Fame.
No. Like Maria, yours
mine was hamburgers, onions, French fries.
Which is a very accurate representation of Maria.
Thank you. And yep. Megan's was
happily over frisbee.
Because you're so over it.
I used to play it, but I'm very over it. And happily so.
Oh God.
So what would your three other HOF words be?
Oh boy. O is hard.
Mm-hmm.
Man. Hot dogs.
Perfect start.
Originate Froehlich. Origami.
Great. These are all great options.
Oh, honey.
Ooh, honey. Yes. Oh, yes. Mm-hmm.
That's a good start.
Honey,
original beast.
Your dog's name is Honey. Your dog's real cute, aww, by the way.
That's a little puffball.
Agree on both fronts that is her name and she's cute.
Thank you. Eric, I want you to tell the listeners a fun fact. It has to be fun. A fun fact about yourself that they don't know.
All right. Your examples. Go ahead.
Great.
Yes, good point.
My example is I just painted my bedroom white.
That's true.
Oh, okay. That sounds really fun. This isn't is going to be a lot easier than I thought.
Wasn't that the funnest fact you ever
my
heard?
My fun fact is I don't like sitting in sinks.
Well, today's a dark day for you, my friend.
Well, as far as fun is concerned.
If you want to give us some home and garden tips about better seating for bathrooms, we're open to it. We're open to
really?
It.
Really?
Yeah. Right.
Yes.
I'll put that in my list for the demands.
Thank you.
Exactly.
That'll be for our next episode.
But we need you to tear out the page in TV Guide where you find your ideas and mail it to us.
I'm not going to ruin an original copy of TV Guide.
Okay, that's fair. You can photocopy it. You can photocopy it so that you keep the original copy intact.
I'm not going to go through the effort of doing that, but if Maria uses her fax machine to send me a copy, mm-hmm, I will then go through the trouble.
Yep. I'm powering it up. Did you hear that?
Beep, boop, beep.
Maria is literally just pushing buttons, random buttons on her printer.
Hitting buttons very loudly.
All right. I don't have a random fact. All of my facts are very purposeful.
God dang it.
Yeah, that's like a tough question to answer. If it has to be more specific, otherwise it gets too random.
Zone likes to ask, what is a book recommendation you have?
Oh, that's a great one.
I have never read a book.
And I already knew. I did my homework. Yeah. Eric Froehlich does not read books.
I've read The Hobbit and The Catcher in the Rye because I wanted to get ahead on like sixth grade reading one summer. And I've never read a book for school. I've just never read a book. I read the first Harry Potter. That was the only book I've read, I think, in the last decade.
Good job.
Thank you.
That's a fun fact.
There you go.
There we did it. That's actually really great.
We got there.
That's a really great fun fact.
Yeah, I haven't opened a textbook.
I had no idea. Textbooks can suck it, though. They're the worst.
That's what I've been trying to say.
Why is their print so tiny?
I don't know.
I wouldn't know.
Yeah.
Nobody knows.
They went to my locker on the first day, and I would carry around an empty backpack for a long time.
My theory is that textbook companies are in league with optometrists. There you go.
Whoa, conspiracy.
It's a conspiracy.
Conspiracy wasn't a magic set. For
dozens of dollars.
Yeah. Yeah. Their optometrists are literally making thousands.
If not hundreds.
If not.
Well, Eric, that's all the time that I've allotted for this episode of Magic the PROthering. Thank you for being our first guest and really kind of breaking in the show and breaking in my sink, which, you know, I haven't had anybody have to, like, hang out near in a long time.
Yeah.
Accommodations were really what put it over the top.
Yeah. A sink's first test of someone sitting on it is always like a really important sink test.
I agree.
You never know.
That is one of the key rules of both home and gardening.
Yeah. It works the exact same way
with bird baths.
We are so doing a spin-off podcast where we talk about home and garden decoration. I hope you're ready for that, Eric, because it's happening.
Yeah, I'll believe it when I see it.
Don't even test me. I start a podcast on a whim.
It's true. Maria will start a podcast at the drop of a hat. And it doesn't even have to be a good hat.
Ooh.
You can drop any hat.
Podcast.
Literally any hat.
Yeah.
Any hat.
I just dropped one.
Just drop it.
Just drop any
new
hat.
Podcast. New
I
podcast.
Dropped it like a tat.
Oh, God.
No. Thank you so much for being on the show. As Maria said, you have set a high bar, sir.
Oh, yeah?
Yes.
It'll be a little bit lower after we sat on it, but...
I quit!
Help! I don't even know... I don't even know what else to add. I am so... It was so great.
Did we even discuss magic yet?
We touched on it. We'll be right back.